For this video, we start to define and describe the equations we'll use to calculate equilibrium quantities. And these equations that we're going to be defining and describing here are called equilibrium expressions. Again, we're going to use our decomposition of N2O4 equation, and we're using our second definition of equilibrium. So remember, in that definition of equilibrium, we described that the rate of the forward reaction equals the rate of reverse. And here we're going to use rate laws to define these rates of reactions. For these rate laws, the first assumption that we make is that we're working with elementary steps here. Remember back from our kinetics chapter, we know that elementary steps are a single step in a mechanism that shows how a process is happening. And so to simplify things, we're going to only work with elementary steps, a single step reaction. What that means is that we know we use our coefficients from our equation as the exponent in our rate law. And so if I want to show the rate of the forward reaction, the N2O4 reacting, remember that in our rate law, we only use reactants. And so the rate of forward, the subscript F is indicating forward. We start with our rate constant, and then we have N2O4. I have a subscript on here denoting that we are talking about our system at equilibrium. And notice that because we have a coefficient of 1, that is first order. Now, if I look at this reaction in the reverse direction, now my NO2 becomes my reactant. I'm using air quotes here. So if we look at the rate of the reverse reaction, we first have our rate constant of the reverse. And then we have NO2, again, at equilibrium. Since it's a coefficient of 2, it is second order. And so now our definition here for equilibrium, once the rate of the forward reaction equals the rate of the reverse reaction, my system is at equilibrium. And that means that I can set my two equations equal to each other. We're going to assume that the equilibrium is implied because we're talking about equilibrium here. I'm going to leave that subscript off. And so we have this, sorry for that typo, this equation. So Kf of N2O4 equals Kr of NO2 squared. Now, by convention, scientists wanted to get all of our constants on one side and concentrations or pressures of substances on the other. And by convention, they chose to get constants on the left. So I'm going to move Kr over, and then I'm going to move my concentrations to the right. So dividing both sides by the N2O4. Now realize I'm never going to ask you to derive an expression like this. I'm just explaining where the expression comes from so that you can use that as you're writing these equations. So summarizing everything that we have now, we have our rate constant of forward divided by rate constant of reverse. Since these are both constants at a given temperature, they become equal to a new constant. And here is where we use a large capital K. So for anything related to kinetics, we're using the lowercase k. Make sure that's small. For equilibrium, again, which we'll be using for the rest of the semester, we use a large capital K for this. And that K is referred to as the equilibrium constant for a reaction. Again, it's constant at a given temperature, and that's because our rate constants were also constant at a given temperature. Specifically for our equation example here, we have NO2 squared over N2O4. As we go through this semester, you'll also see as we discuss equilibrium systems, we often assign a subscript on the equilibrium constant to describe our system and what we're talking about. In this case, if we use the letter C as the subscript, it means that we are measuring concentrations of substances in order to measure our equilibrium constant. And the two key things to note, so rather than going through this derivation every time, when we write our equilibrium expression, we always follow the same two key steps. The first is that we always write it as products over reactants. And the second is that we're always going to assume for the rest of the semester that we're using elementary steps, and so your coefficients will be your exponents. So these two key steps will be used for the rest of the semester. So on the next slide, I have all of this typed out. Again, this Kc value, capital K, is our equilibrium constant. This equation is called the equilibrium expression. And so again, that capital K comes from the ratio of our two rate constants of the forward and reverse reactions. Some subscripts that you'll see as we go through this chapter and this semester. If you see the subscript I next to a concentration or pressure, that's measuring our initial or starting amount. The EQ tells us that we are specifically measuring equilibrium. Equilibrium doesn't have to be listed because if you're working with an equilibrium constant, then that EQ is implied. Again, the two steps for writing our equilibrium expressions, products over reactants, and the coefficients are the orders or the exponents. So our general notation, if we have this balanced equation of A and B with coefficients in there, this is our general setup for an equilibrium expression. So of course, our next step then is to practice. First thing to notice for any given chemical equation is, since we're using our coefficients as exponents, we have to know the balancing. I'm only going to work through the first problem with you here. In the notes, I've left the answers, and so I want you to work on those to make sure you understand how to set them up and then check yourself. And so for this one, again, working our first equation here, we do have to balance our equation first. I'll encourage you to take a second to balance these. And if you haven't paused the video yet, pause the video to balance. I'm going to go through and just show the answers here so we can work on our equilibrium expression. So again, for number one, again, remember that we are always writing as products over reactants. And then our coefficients are the exponents. The only one that has a non-1 exponent is our hydrogen. So hydrogen would be cubed. This is our equilibrium expression for the first equation. So again, I encourage you to practice numbers 2 and 3, balancing and writing your expressions. However, the next concept that we need to discuss is the differences with phases and with a different Kp expression. So the P that we're showing here stands for pressures. And when we're measuring the pressures of substances, a Kp would be written, the expression would be written using the same rules, products over reactants, coefficients are the exponents. But of course, we have to use a different notation when we're working with pressures. Remember that specifically when we're working with Kc, we are measuring concentrations using those square brackets. But I can't use that notation for pressures. So when we write a Kp expression, we'll have a slightly different notation to use. The other thing that we have to pay attention to are the physical states of substances. Like with catalysts, we can describe equilibrium as being either homogeneous, where all substances are in the same physical state, or heterogeneous, when the substances are in a different phase. For Kc expressions, again, we're using concentrations. For Kc expressions, we will only use gas and aqueous substances. For Kp expressions, because we're measuring pressures, the only substances that we can measure pressures of are gases. So Kps only include gases. Notice for both of these types of expressions, we don't list solids or liquids. And that's because they have constant concentrations. So a quick diagram here to illustrate that point. Let's say we have a powder solid reactant. All right, powder form, it's granules here. If I were to measure the molarity for this solid, of course, I would need to know moles per liter. But over time, since this is a reactant, realize that slowly reactants will get used up. And so I'm erasing part of my, trying to erase parts of my reactants. So notice as this reactant is getting used up, the number of moles is decreasing, right? The amount is decreasing, but notice the volume is also decreasing here. And the same would apply for liquids. So solids and liquids have constant concentrations, which means that we don't need to know a difference between initial and equilibrium because that amount would be the same. So we never include solids or liquids in our expressions. All right, erasing this drawing so that we can practice writing a Kc and a Kp for these two equations down here. So best hint, if you're asked to write expressions and you notice that you have a solid or a liquid, is to simply cross it out. It won't be included in our expression at all. So we'll have CO squared over CO2 first order for our Kc. Let's try Kc for the second one. So same thing. Notice I have a solid here on the product side, which means I need to use a placeholder of 1 in the numerator. And then both of my reactants, they are aqueous, so they can be included in a Kc. Both of our reactants would be included here. And of course, chloride has that coefficient of 2, so it will be squared. So those are our Kc expressions, again, using concentrations. Now we want to work on writing a Kp expression. Again, for Kps, we follow the same rules, but we can only include gases. So in the first equation, we're going to still include carbon monoxide and carbon dioxide. The difference in my notation here is that I have to describe this as the pressure of carbon monoxide. So it's a capital P with a subscript of the substance and then squaring it. In the denominator, I would write the pressure of CO2. Parentheses are not necessary because in the bottom it's first order. Parentheses are optional if you want to include them though. So again, notice we still have products over reactants and we're still using our coefficients as the orders. We just have a different notation. Notice for our second one, I don't have any gases in here. So the temptation would be, since I used a placeholder for my solid, to use a placeholder for my reactants here, since they're not gases either. But realize if I do that, what I'm saying is that my Kp value is a value of 1. But since I don't have any gases in here, I can't give it a value. And so if you have no gases, you have no Kp value. It cannot be calculated or measured. And so without any gases, there is no Kp value. The next slide in the notes is a great one for you to practice, and I'll leave this to you to work on. Again, I highly recommend covering the answers. Make sure you know how to write these. But writing, notice these are already balanced for you, writing a Kc and a Kp expression for each of these equations.